Today I want to talk about Evans's paper on the causal theory of names. So let's start by thinking about, well, the nature of the dispute between Kripke and the description theorist. We might think, what's going on in any of these accounts? There's really a sort of picture where we've got someone using a name. So I've been drawing these little diagrams of the person having a thought, let's say, in using a name. Let's just refer to that as N. And so they say something. And then the question is, what object, if any, does N refer to? So it's the reference relation we're interested in illuminating. And the description theory says, well, there is this body of information that the person has associated with N. And it's that body of information that gives us the key to understanding what N refers to. Now, what is the relationship between the information and the object? Well, the idea is that the information contains a description or some set of descriptions or something, right? We can get vague about this. But there is some way of combining the information here to get something like a description associated with a name, a set, the weighted most of which is going to determine the reference. But it's a question of whether the object satisfies that information. And so the relationship here is really one of satisfaction. It's one of truth, if you want to think of it that way. Is that information true of that object? And the idea is that if, for example, this is the thing denoted by the description, then great, we've got reference. If not, no, we don't. Okay? Now, what is the causal theory doing? Well, it basically says, wait a minute, we don't need a body of information. This relationship between the name and the object it refers to is essentially a causal relation. And so you might think, right, this is one way to go. This is the descriptive theory. But causal theory says that's the wrong way to look at it. Instead, focus on that relationship between the name and the object. There's got to be a reference-preserving causal link between my use of the name and the object itself. So I think Aristotle, what does Aristotle refer to? Who cares what information I associate with Aristotle? I look back to see where I got the name. And ultimately, it should trace back to Aristotle. So according to causal theory, this referential relation is really a causal relationship. And it's true that associated with a name is some body of information, but it really doesn't play any interesting role in determining the referent. It could be that I'm referring to some object that I have entirely false beliefs about. Now, what Evans does is suggest that actually what we need is a combination of these theories. So let's start with his criticisms of the purely causal theory, and then we'll see how he tries to combine these in the kind of picture that he works for. But let's see, how can we do this? Well, let's think first of all about the question of whether this causal chain, these reference-preserving links of a chain, actually give us a successful account. So we've seen that one way of characterizing the causal theory is this. We can say a causal theory of reference, or at any rate of proper names, says that the name refers to an object. Let's say N refers to O if there is a chain of reference preserving links or transfers going back to an initial baptism of that object O. Now, I don't have N in here, so I've got to sort of put that in. If there is a chain of reference-preserving transfers, well, going back from what? Right? Going back to an initial baptism of O from my usage of this name N. So the picture is this. I'm going to succeed in referring if I can trace my use of the name back to this initial baptism of the object. And if I can, then I'm referring to the object initially baptized with this name, or some name causally related to it. After all, the Greeks didn't call Aristotle Aristotle. and the French don't call Paris Paris and all of that. But there is this sort of, there's enough of a preservation in these links to preserve reference, even if it doesn't preserve exactly the form of the name. Now, Evan says, well, wait, we need to think about whether this sort of chain is sufficient for reference. We also need to think about whether it's necessary for reference. So let's think first of all about the question of whether this is sufficient. Suppose there is a chain. Here I am, let's say, and I am using this name N. And the idea is I got that ultimately from people who were baptizing the object, O. And of course, this might be quite quick. It might be a long-term thing. I suppose the simplest case is where I'm simply the one who's doing the dubbing myself. And so the chain is really just this one link. Now, is the existence of such a chain sufficient? Whenever we've got that, are we referring to that object? Well, Evans gives us a number of cases to think about. Most of them are just presented very quickly in a paragraph. So some of them, I think, require a little bit of elaboration to be fully convincing. But let's take his case of Lewis. These guys are sitting around in a bar. Okay, and they're talking about some fellow named Lewis. You walk in, and you overhear their conversation. And everybody's laughing and cracking jokes about this guy. And so you actually make a few funny comments of your own about Lewis, even though you don't really know who they're talking about, right? All you know is that they're calling this guy Lewis. And so you're sitting around, whoa, Lewis must be such a dope, etc. Now, who are you referring to when you then use the term Lewis? Well, there is a chain going back to whoever these people are talking about. In Evan's example, you can tell he taught at Oxford, right? His example ends up being Louis XIII of France. I don't know many people who sit around in a bar cracking jokes about Louis XIII of France. But whoever it is, it goes back, right, to some initial baptism, and that's who they're really talking about. Now, is this person, then, in cracking that joke, actually talking about that particular Lewis who starts the chain? Maybe some French king, maybe some friend, whatever. Now, here's Evan's idea, I think. It isn't actually the case that you're referring to that Lewis. Or at least by the end of the article, it emerges that, well, maybe in a sense you are, but purely deferentially. That is to say, you have no idea who this guy is. You don't even know who you're talking about. Instead, you're just piggybacking on their reference. And so they're referring to someone. You pick up the name from them. You say something. Are you really referring to that person? You don't even know who you're talking about. In fact, somebody who said, oh, you know Lewis too. Oh, well, no, not really. Or somebody comes up and overhears you and said, oh, who is this Lewis guy you're talking about? Something you find you don't know. I mean, I don't know if this has ever happened to you, but sometimes that has happened to me, or confession time. I tend to, in certain circumstances, fake it, okay? I want to seem like I know what's going on, and I know what people are talking about, even when I don't. And I always warn freshmen, by the way, in orientation against this. You're going to be tempted to nod and pretend like you know what's going on when you don't. And that way you don't learn anything. To learn something, you have to say, could you explain, or who is that, and so on. But I admit, there are times when I don't do that. So people are talking about something. I think, yeah, well, an embarrassing case a few years ago that I mentioned in one of these orientation sessions, and it's still true, even though one of the orientation advisors got me the book and said, here, read it, cure this problem. But okay, there are certain great works of literature that lots of people have read. In fact, lots of people have read in high school that I have never read. And I don't want to admit that I've never read them, right? Because it makes me sound stupid not to have read them. So somebody makes a reference to Huckleberry Finn, for example, right? And look, most people, by the time they get through high school and college, have read Mark Twain and have read Huckleberry Finn. I never have. Even though I lived in a town that had the Mark Twain house, and many of my friends worked at the Mark Twain house and all this, still, I never read Huckleberry Finn. And even though this person got me that as a gift, I still haven't read it. But somebody comes up and starts talking about Huckleberry Finn, and I don't want to say, yeah, look, I've been a professor for almost 40 years, and I still have to read Huckleberry Finn, so I pretend I have, right? I just nod wisely. No, it's a good observation. Yeah. No, I've always thought so, right? And I sound like I know what I'm talking about. In fact, since I'm agreeing with this person, they think, oh, he's so smart. He really understands this well. And I don't know at all what's going on. Now, Huckleberry Finn, at least I know what the referent is, even though I've never read it. But what if it's some work? Or what if it's some person that I really have never heard of before? And the person says, well, of course, you've read so-and-so, right? I don't even know who that is. At least in the case of Huckleberry Finn, I know what I'm missing. But in this case, right, I might nod and say, oh yeah, it's very interesting. I read it a long time ago. Okay, that's my standard way of trying to cheat. If I ever say that, I'm probably lying. It might be true. The other night I actually said that it was true. I had read it a long time ago, but often it's a lie. Anyway, here's the point. If then somebody says, oh, so tell me about that. Right? Then I'm suddenly like, oh crap, I don't know anything about it. Am I succeeding in referring? Now Kripke would say, yes, I'm succeeding in referring, even though I have no idea what I'm talking about, because that person knew who they're referring to, and I'm just piggybacking on their reference, and I'm getting the name from somebody who does presumably know what they're talking about, and so I succeed in referring. But Evans is more skeptical. He says, wait, what do you mean you succeed in referring to this person? You have no idea who that is. And so, you know, I find my own intuitions torn on this kind of case. Do I succeed in referring to Lewis or referring to this, I don't know, obscure philosopher that I think, probably I should have heard that of that person, but I never have, or whatever? I don't know whether in those cases. Yeah, anyway, yeah.
This to me feels like you wouldn't succeed, because how do you know that the other person knows what they're trying to refer to? And if they're intentionally saying something that's correct or incorrect. Like, there's, like, a running joke, and I'm probably going to butcher this anyway, but, like, when somebody refers to some Bible verses they don't know, it's in, like, First Hezekiah, right? Is that the one? It doesn't exist. But if you didn't know that, then, like, you might think that, oh, yeah, you're referring to First Hezekiah. Like, that's definitely a book in the Bible, but it's not. So.
Right. Well, that's a great point. And I have met certain people who like to trip people up this way. You know, they'll still say, oh, you're familiar with blah, 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 blah. And they try to get you to say, no, there's no such book. Right, whatever.
That's so rude.
Yeah, it's terrible. I hate people like that. but yeah, you could say, right, I mean, here's the problem in a way that he's pointing out. In this sort of case, you just have no information. And so not only can you not pick out the person, you have no way of knowing whether the person you're getting it from actually can pick out the person, right? Maybe they don't know either. It would be, in fact, really embarrassing if you do follow the advice I always give the freshman, but don't take myself, and say, well, I don't know. Who are you talking about? Who is this Lewis? And they all say, actually, we don't know. There was some guy sitting up at the bar when we were getting the drinks that was talking about this guy. Right? Then it's kind of like, wait, I don't know if you even know what's going on. Maybe that guy was one of these people who pulls people's legs. And so yeah, there are a number of reasons why you might side with Evans here. First of all, you do have no information. You don't know who you're referring to. Secondly, for all you know, there might be no referent at all. This might all be a trick. You have no way of knowing, in other words, this causal chain leads back anywhere. Now, there's a way of taking that, making it a general skeptical thing. How do you know there was an Aristotle? Maybe it's all some plot cooked up by ancient philosophers or medieval philosophers to make you think there was this great ancient figure. There was no such person. Or maybe Aristotle was actually not one person, but just a bunch of people. Kind of like the French mathematician Bourbaki, who wrote all these works in the 50s. There was no Bourbaki. It was just a team of mathematicians that did that. So you think, ooh, yeah, what if Aristotle was just like this team of Greek philosophers who pretend to be one brilliant person? Yeah. But anyway, here's the idea. Even if we have this, it's not clear you succeed in referring. If you have no information, no way of checking that there really is such an object, no reason, in a sense, for confidence that this chain leads anywhere. Even if it does, you don't have any reason to believe it does. and you don't have any idea where it leads.
Yeah.
Well, what does it mean for a theory to be sufficient for reference? Because it seems like mostly when we're referring to things in conversations, all we need is to be able to refer about as well as other people in the conversation. So if you pick up on something somebody's saying, even if they're wrong, you're still like doing okay in your conversation.
Right. Well, I meant this condition as being sufficient. So really, that if there is such a chain, then you do succeed in referring to that object. But one way of taking the Wittgensteinian thought, that in the end meaning is use and maybe reference is just use, is that you're right, all you really need is to get by in the conversation. And so, since I'm interested in learning, I tell the freshman, ask questions, don't do what I sometimes do. However, you might say, well actually, no, do what I sometimes do, fake it, okay? There's a lot of times here, you're not really gonna know what you're doing, but you're gonna have to turn in the assignment anyway, or answer the question on the exam. So fake it, and here are keys for faking it and getting by, right? And you might think, actually, that's what life is all about. It's not about really being anything. It's just faking it and getting by.
Primary teaching of Wittgenstein?
That's right, primary teaching of Wittgenstein. No, I'm not advocating this view, but you might think so, right? And so you could say, well, actually, what matters here is not that you succeed in having any information or being having an idea of where that change leads, or even confidence with reasons that leads anywhere. You're getting by in the conversation. They're laughing about Lewis, and you're laughing about Lewis, and you're saying things and they approve, right? So what do you mean you're not succeeding in referring? That's one way of defending Kripke against this attack, by saying, what more do I want? I'm getting by in the conversation. Now, it is a little tricky. When I've been to Latin America, I can understand a lot in Spanish, but when people start telling jokes, and it depends on wordplay, I often miss what's going on. Even if I understand the words, I don't see why that's funny, because I don't understand these idioms and these additional uses of the word and so on. But I learned to laugh when other people are laughing. And so the last time I was in Costa Rica, people were commending me on my Spanish by the end. Wow, you're doing so well, you're getting all the jokes. Well, I wasn't getting the jokes. I was just realizing, okay, other people are laughing at. Must have been a joke. And I could do that really well. So I pretended. In fact, they thought I was actually knowing the Spanish, right? When in fact, I just knew when to laugh. And so you might say, that's a little bit like this. Was I succeeding in, that if I repeated something back, was I succeeding in referring? Arguably, no more than the parrot John Locke talks about. It's just spouting phrases. Is the parrot succeeding in referring? There is a causal chain, right? The parrot got the word from the pirate that the parrot lived with or something. But still, you might say the parrot. Parrot isn't actually referring to anything. And in a sense, in the bar, talking about Lewis, or maybe me laughing at the Spanish jokes and repeating something, really, I'm just acting like a parrot. Yeah.
So even if you don't know, taking the example of Lewis, if you don't know necessarily who that person is, or whether it in your head, whether it correctly refers or not, what metaphysically does correctly refer, so wouldn't that still be sufficient in that case?
Well, a good point. You might say, look, you're taking part in a conversation, and let's assume these people do know this Lewis guy, and they do succeed in referring to him. Then there is one perspective from which it's very strange to say you aren't succeeding in referring. You're sitting there, and let's say you're not even pretending. They say something, and you say, wow, that Lewis guy, he must be ridiculous or something. And you don't know him, but it seems like that's a perfectly legitimate thing to say, right? It's not only that you get by with it. It seems like you're not even there making any claim to have any information. You're just saying, Lewis sounds like a jerk, let's say. And that's a case where, well, what? It seems to me you're actually referring to Lewis and saying, that guy sounds like a jerk, aren't you?
So, but, would this go along with the argument against, if two people are in a conversation and one of them refers, is like, do you remember Lewis from our class, but there were two Lewises in the class and each of them referred to the different one, would you say it's not sufficient then? Just
their chain of reference. Oh, okay. Yeah, we're going to talk a lot about cases like that where there are actually two people who fit the usage of the term. And it might be that there are two people who fit whatever descriptive content you have, but it could also be that there are two people at the end of the causal chain. So he thinks a lot about twins, or about this guy Turnip, or Napoleon being, you know, referring to one guy at up to a certain time, and then somebody else who's an imposter after that time. So let me postpone discussion of that for a few minutes. But you're right, you might worry that if I succeed in having a chain that goes back to one of these people, but there are others indiscernible, or who get mixed up in the causal chain, or who are, share all the same information, then in that case, I haven't succeeded in picking out which one I'm talking about. Which guy named Lewis? Which twin? Which, you know, the earlier Napoleon or the imposter Napoleon, etc. Yeah.
As far as, like, succeeding and failing for reference, wouldn't that be really contextual, too? Because I was just thinking about, like, works of fiction, you know, the initial baptism would just be when the author conceives of a name for a fictional person.
Right.
And, you know, if you're in an English class and you're talking about a character in a book, like, I would imagine that would be succeeding in reference, but you're not actually referring to anything. So what would the difference between that and, like, referring to somebody who you never met and have no idea about? Why would that fail? And how, like, would you be succeeding in referring to something even if the fictional character wasn't real?
You're asking hard questions. I mean, in this case, actually, let me put here the multiple thing. We'll talk about it more later, but there is an issue there. But now, yeah, we get this question of fiction. And that is a really interesting question, because if somebody introduces a term like Voldemort, we were talking about last time, you get the sense that we might have this discussion of Voldemort, or actually, I got into a big discussion at one point with somebody about Dumbledore. Well, in fact, in here we mentioned that conversation about Dumbledore earlier, where, you know, from one point of view, he's this great guy. He's the grand wizard who is on the good side and who is Harry's mentor and all of that. But from another point of view, realizes, or at least thinks throughout the whole thing, he can only destroy Voldemort if Harry is destroyed. And so he's like plumping him up for the slaughter, the entire thing. And then you can think, wait a minute, I don't know if Dumbledore is such a good guy anymore. But it feels like we're arguing about Dumbledore, right? Or we're talking about Voldemort, and you get the sense we're succeeding in referring to the same thing. And yet, if we trace the causal chain back, what do we find? We don't find Voldemort. We don't find Dumbledore. We find J.K. Rowling sitting in a room, you know, writing the story and using that name for the first time. And so something very special happens in the case of fiction, where it feels as if, actually, the chain doesn't lead back to an object. It leads back to somebody introducing this in a very special kind of context. And that, too, would be reason to think. Well, actually, I suppose that would be reason for thinking maybe this chain isn't necessary. It doesn't have to go back to the object. It has to go back to something, some introduction of the name. But that isn't always the baptism of an object, unless we think of a fictional character as an object. So one way to go here is to say, yeah, well, there's a special kind of fictional object. And we just have to figure out what it is to baptize a fictional object. From another point of view, we have to go back to, don't think of it as a baptism of a thing or a dubbing of a thing. Think of it as the introduction to a name, of a name. And there is a sort of condition of appropriate introduction. And that's going to vary somewhat, depending upon whether the object really exists or whether it's a fiction. And so I think either way, we have to generalize something. We can generalize this notion of, where did I put it? Yeah, of a baptism to include that. Or we could actually introduce fictional objects as objects.
Well, because it's especially relevant because I feel like people talk about fictional characters without knowing anything about them more than they do real people. You know, in any English class, for somebody who hasn't read the readings, you're going to talk within the context of the conversation about something that's not real, just the same as someone that you don't know.
Right. That's true. A surprising number of people in English courses.
Yeah.
Talk without having read the book. And so, they're following my advice. Just figure out what you need to do to get by. And when the professor says something, you know, you just nod wisely and say, yes, I totally agree with you about Iago. I don't know who that is, but whatever. So anyway, that's something that would lead us to think, right, what's going on in these cases? It looks as if, you're right, even if there isn't, well, I suppose there's still a chain, right? In the sense that you're picking it up from the other people in the class who have read the book, let's say. Or maybe none of them have read the book except the professor. Or maybe the professor is even faking it and going on with notes or something. But eventually you get somebody who actually has read the book in this chain and goes back. But in the case of a fictional character, one gets the sense that, wait a minute, whatever you say about this, the causal chain doesn't go where you might expect it to go. It doesn't go to a thing. Whereas the body of information seems really important. And in fact, you might think it is even more important. Because I can easily imagine that there's some object that I've been naming that I'm just wrong about. Everything I've said about it is wrong. But it's not so easy for me to imagine a fictional character where everything, let's say that anybody has thought about this character is wrong. What would that even be like? I mean, that I could be wrong about everything, yes. But that we all could be wrong, that seems impossible in the case of a fictional character. And yet it seems quite possible in the case of a real person, let's say. There might have been somebody, and yet all our beliefs about that person are wrong. But what would it mean to say there's a fictional character, but all our beliefs about that person are wrong?
Yeah. It means a new book came out and there's a twist. Everybody's wrong about Snape. And then the seventh book comes out.
Oh, right. Yeah, well.
Very true, exactly.
Yeah?
That information is completely arbitrary. It's like, how could you be incorrectly referring to something that's just arbitrarily been created from nothing? I mean, Are you failing in referring to something if you're just incorrectly referring to whoever created that term had initially thought? I mean, it just doesn't make sense. It seems kind of blurry.
Well, yeah. Yeah, no, that's a really interesting challenge.
I think, like, if I'm talking about the fictional character and the author, so if your ideas of that fictional character deviates from the original creator, then you'd be incorrectly referring, I think. But also, it's contingent upon Rowling, in this case.
Right.
Whatever she says goes.
Yeah, but that's what I'm saying. If it's completely arbitrary like that, how could you possibly fail? I mean, it just seems like there's no real standard.
Right. Well, I'm envisioning three scenarios. So let me see if this makes sense to you. Here's scenario one. We hear tell of a lost work of ancient fiction, and we have beliefs based on some oblique references to it in ancient texts of what this ancient text was and what character was about and what happened to this character. In fact, we're completely wrong. Okay. In fact, let's say there was such a book, but that character was nothing like what we think of, and so on. And so we have a few second, third, remote accounts of this thing. Nobody's ever actually read the work. And we have these views turn out to be totally wrong. So that would be case one. Case two, more like your case. Somebody is trying to act cool, has a bunch of friends who are talking about comic books, and they're referring to Batman. And you don't know who that is exactly, but you think, you start acting as, I read some comic book about some character one time, and it was Superman, let's say. You thought Batman flies, right? Superman flies. Oh, all right, so you start talking about Superman, and you might say you're totally wrong. Well, maybe that's not a case where, because they both fly, so it's not like everything is wrong, but still, or maybe you just hear the part about, he's Bruce Wayne, he's a millionaire, so you think, he's like Jay Gatsby, and so you think Bruce Wayne is Jay Gatsby. I don't know, I'm trying to think, but now I'm still finding some common element. I'm trying to make you seem less insane than you have to be in order for this scenario to work. It's got to be the case that everything you think about this character is wrong. You sort of misidentify one character for another. Maybe you just are remembering the book, but it was a long time ago, and you mistake which character was which, something like that. And then the other case is the case where the author tricks you, right? Gets you to think one thing about the character, and then it turns out it's not like that. Now, usually, that has the form not of the author saying, look, none of that really happened, nothing I said in the earlier books is right. Instead, you were led to infer things about a character's character, and then you find out it's not what you thought. But it might be the first thing. Lawrence Durrell wrote The Alexandria Quartet. It's one of four novels. And it essentially tells the same story, but from four different perspectives. So each book covers the same rough plot, but from a totally different angle. And all of the narrators are quite unreliable. And so you see how it looks from this person's point of view, or at least how they want you to think it looks from their point of view. And then you find out, oh, wait, here's another. And so you find out in some cases the other narrator was lying, or at least they were deeply wrong about what's going on. So you read book one, you think such and such. And then you read book two and say, oh, wait a minute, that didn't happen. That was, you know, that was made up. That's what that person wanted to happen. And then you read book three and say, oh, wait a minute, maybe that was wrong, and so on. And so all of those are ways. And in short, the author might be part of the one who's changing this up on you. Maybe it's just that you don't know what's going on. Maybe you substitute one work for another. But what's going on in all those cases is that the descriptive content somehow comes away from the character that you think you're referring to. And here would be one thought. Well, then you fail to refer. Okay, that's sort of the description theory thing. Or maybe you're referring to Jay Gatsby instead of Batman and so on. But on the other perspective, we'd have to tell this causal story. And then you're still talking about Batman. You're still talking about Snape or what have you. But in the end, you just have a lot of false beliefs about it. So I think that in a way, this does bring out not only the need to make some revisions here, but also it really makes the view, or the thing that separates the description theory and the causal theory, pretty stark. And it's going to be something Evan's theory, in the end, has a lot of implications about. But let me move back to this question of whether we've got something here that's necessary for reference. Do we have to have a chain that leads back? Here is, he gives a weird example, but an example I don't actually fully understand. It's about Kingston. This guy's on a quiz show and has to identify the capital of Jamaica. And so he says, Kingston. Okay, maybe it's Jeopardy, the capital of Jamaica. Question, what is Kingston? Now, does this in chain go back to Kingston, Jamaica? Well, let's say it's not the case. As he was on the bus going to the quiz show, he heard some racist make a remark about Kingston upon Thames. And the racist says, Kingston is the capital of Jamaica. Okay? Meaning there are lots of Jamaicans living in Kingston upon Thames. And now here's part of the reason I don't fully understand the story. How clever is this racist, right? Does the racist know that that's a joke because Kingston is the capital of Jamaica? And, you know, or is it just pure chance? Anyway, I think if the racist is like making a clever joke, then it actually does go back to Kingston, Jamaica, and the chain is legit. But here's, I guess, the point of the example. The guy somehow succeeds in the quiz show and refers to Kingston, the capital of Jamaica, even though this, let's assume it's a dumb racist who has no particular awareness of the fact that Kingston really is the capital of Jamaica. And therefore, it's purely by chance. So he succeeds in referring, even though there's no chain going back to them. Now, that should make you, nervous. Right.
But can you clarify why he's a racist?
Well, that's because Evans calls him a racist. I mean, to refer to an ethnic group as living in a neighborhood, I don't think that's in itself racist. I mean,
and how he doesn't guess they're all Jamaican, he could be making an assumption. Talk to everybody there.
I don't know. That's a part of the story that isn't told. I mean, I come from a city where there's a whole neighborhood called Polish Hill because Polish people live there. And nobody thinks it's racist to say, oh yeah, a lot of Polish people live on Polish Hill. So I'm not sure why it's racist to say what the guy says in the story. But anyway, this isn't a class about racism, so I don't know what to say about that. But the point is, the usage is sort of accidental, right? It's not actually tied back to the Kingston he's referring to. Okay, so the thought is, well, that shows it's not necessary, because he succeeds in referring even though this condition fails. Now, is that right? Does he succeed in referring?
His intent isn't there.
Well, the intent, in a way, is there. He wants to get the question right. The capital of Jamaica. What is Kingston? So he's trying to refer to the capital of Jamaica. On the other hand, you're right. There's something missing.
But the intent of
wanting to answer the question, like, for the sake of winning, or the intent of trying, accurately making that thing, like, the answer to, what is it, being categorical make, I think, are two different intents. So.
Right. Well, that's true. Yeah, I mean, intending to get the question right, that's a little bit like his point about intending to get by, as opposed to intending to actually refer to that thing. So you're right, I mean, getting the answer right on a quiz show is a different, and you might say, I mean, look, he might say, I just care what the coast is going to read on my card. I don't care what the captain Jamaica really is. I just care what it says on that card and what will count as the right answer. And so that's a nice way of just differentiating these two goals. Anyway, does he succeed in referring to Kingston in this case? Yeah.
He definitely refers to one of the Kingstons, right? He either refers to Kingston on Thames or... Right?
I mean, one way of looking at this is to say, all right, Kingston in his speech there actually, according to Pripke, should go back to Kingston upon Thames.
Yeah.
And so, is that really the capital of Jamaica in the sense of being asked by the quiz master? No. And so, from that point of view, he says something false, but he gets by because actually those two places have the same name. Yeah.
Yeah, I think what you were saying is correct that you know, he's referring to Kingston on Thames, but he still gets the question right regardless, just by some accident, right?
Right.
So he's still referring, it seems, to Kingston upon Thames. Why does he have to refer to the Kingston actually in Jamaica to get the answer right? You know, you can be confused and refer to something else.
Right. Yeah, he doesn't have to, right? Yeah, exactly. I mean, it seems to me there are other cases where people get things right without having any idea what they're doing, just by producing the right sound at the right time. Yeah?
Can we think of reference as, like, I feel like when we're talking about reference, it's like how I refer when you're talking about an object, but I think of it as something that when you refer, like if someone else refers to it, how you react. So if he was talking about Kingston and everyone else made the connection, doesn't make the reference.
All right, good. There is a distinction that both Kripke and Evans draw between the speaker's reference and the semantic reference. And so we need to distinguish what the speaker is actually referring to from what the community is referring to. And you might say one way of understanding what happens in the quiz show here is that the speaker is really referring to Kingston upon Thames, but that the community is taking him to refer to Kingston, Jamaica, because he just uses Kingston, and because that would be the more salient connection to draw in this case. And so you might think, yeah, what's happening here is he just gets lucky, right? He uses the term that actually succeeds with respect to its semantic reference, but he personally is actually using it to refer to something else. It's as if, you know, I mentioned there was a professor in my undergraduate college who had a cat named Metaphysics. It's as if, you know, somebody calls him up and says, what course should I take next term, professor? And the cat suddenly does something bad. He shouts, metaphysics! Okay, meaning to yell at the cat. The student says, great, thanks! So I'm like, yeah, that worked. Okay, he was referring to the cat, but the student takes him to be referring to the area of philosophy or the course being offered next term. And let's say it is a good course and so on. The student comes up and says, thanks, professor, it was great advice. Somehow it all works out because by luck the semantic reference and the speaker reference manage to coincide enough that it succeeds. Well, I shouldn't say the reference coincides, it's just that circumstances coincide enough that you don't notice the difference in reference and what works in one case sort of works in the other two by accident. Yeah.
So how does like the personal and the semantic reference like refer to like how we relate with
there really is a big philosophical issue that divides these theories, and I've been jumping into the details and in a sense leaving out some aspects of the big picture. Why does anybody care about this? I took a graduate seminar in the philosophy of mind my first year, and it was all about this stuff. We read papers on definite descriptions and proper names all semester. And I had been thinking, oh, this could be a course about the mind-body problem. And I admit, most of the way through I was thinking, what does any of this have to do with the philosophy of mind? But here is, in a sense, the answer. How do we link up to the world? We've been talking about this big philosophical question of how the mind relates to the world, and sort of parallel to that, to some extent, how language, how the word relates to the world. Well, here we have two very different accounts of how thought or word and the world are related. Because here the object, we're talking about the world now here, right? And here, in this body of information, we're talking about the mind. Here, we're talking about, well, an item of language. And now the question is, well, how do those link up together? The description theory is based on the following thought. Thoughts and speech relate to the world by way of information, by way of descriptions. We basically identify properties in the world, or we have terms and we find their application conditions match the world on the basis of what those terms mean and the body of information that we have about the world. And so you might put it this way. What's involved in all these descriptive things in that body of information? Concepts. So our link to the world goes through certain concepts. And over here, the causal theory says, no, it doesn't have to go through concepts. In fact, this is often referred to as a theory of direct reference. It's direct. We directly link to the world. So think back to Russell's theory of descriptions. He's saying, descriptions look like referring expressions, but they're really not. They're really something like quantifiers, and it is by virtue of the descriptive content that we're able to actually connect to something in the world. But that's all knowledge by description. It is not by acquaintance. And Kripke's objection, in a sense, is all centered around the thought that, no, at certain points, thought and language relate directly to the world. And so if I refer to this desk and call it Billy, then I am directly connected to that. There's no set of concepts in between me and the world. It's not like there is always this screen between me and the world. Kripke's saying, no, there are times when I just connect to the world directly. So one way of looking at this is to say Kripke is rejecting the entire, you might say, set of assumptions that most philosophers have had ever since Kant, that in between us and the world there is this body of concepts, and we only can refer to things and think thoughts at all by virtue of concepts that organize the data of experience into some kind of thing. So this starts out in Kant being the thought that we need these concepts of the understanding to organize experience to have any thoughts at all. In Hegel, it becomes the view that there really is this conceptual screen, you might say, that holds us off away from the thing in itself so completely. There's no point in talking about things in themselves at all, in a sense, that's outside of that web. It becomes in postmodernism the thought that really there's nothing there but the text. There's nothing there but concepts, language, things that screen us off from reality. And Kripke's saying all of that is wrong. There is a direct link between what I say and something in the world, at least when I use a proper name. And so if I use a name for one of you, and then I'm directly referring to you. There's no concept that gets in the way. There's no pure concepts of the understanding that are required to construct that. No, I'm directly linked to the world. And so there is a very sort of direct realism lying behind Kripke's view. And the descriptive view was, it's interesting because Russell thought of himself as rebelling against idealism. But it's as if he never got out of the bag, right? He kept punching at the bag and couldn't punch his way through, except maybe with demonstrators like this and that. But it hardly ever comes up from Russell's point of view that he's directly referring to the world, whereas for Kripke, we're doing it all the time. Now, there's a kind of postmodernist that says, well, actually, it's not so much internal concepts. It is just more language that's separating us. And there's a sense in which that's what Evans is doing. His main argument actually isn't these. It's one we'll have to mention quickly now. It's reference change. He doesn't see how it's possible, on a pure causal theory, to explain how reference can change over time. So here's one example. Madagascar. I was having dinner with somebody one time, and we started talking about Madagascar. My daughter was there, and she was thinking, finally, something fun to talk about, thinking we were going to discuss the movie and penguins and stuff like that. And no, we were talking about Gareth Evans' paper. And she quickly realized, oh, you're actually talking about Madagascar, the place, not Madagascar, the movie. But here's the idea. That used to refer to an item on the shore, on the African mainland. And then the reference gradually shifted to the island off the coast of Africa. And that's something that, well, if we're thinking in these terms, we'd say, well, the chain goes back to the place on the coast. So actually, almost everything you've heard about Madagascar is wrong. And not just because of the animated movie, because it's not really an island, it's an area on the shore, etc. And Evans wants to say, no, at some point the reference changed. But there's no way for a reference to really change here, unless there's just a new baptism. But the point here is that there was never a point when people said, you know, it'd be a lot more useful to use this term for the island. It just gradually happened. And then we've got these cases of, well, they're sort of similar cases, of substitution. So we've got Napoleon, who gets replaced by the imposter. We have Turnip, the guy who's around the village, then he leaves, then somebody comes back and he looks a lot like him, and so the villagers continue to call him Turnip, even though it's not the same person. So we have two Turnips. We also have the case of the twins, where you introduce a net, the villagers start talking about Goldilocks. And they have in mind one particular girl they've seen around the village. And there is a causal link, and they can describe her, but it turns out she's one of identical twins. And sometimes they've seen one, sometimes they've seen the other. In Joe Camp's book, Confusion, he introduces the case of Charlie the Ant. It's very similar. You have an ant farm, and there's one particular ant you're very fond of, and you call him Charlie, and you follow this little ant, and maybe you start writing a story about Charlie's adventures day to day. And in fact, there are two ants that look just alike. And it turns out sometimes you're seeing one, sometimes you're seeing the other. Yeah.
Have you read that book called On Bullshit?
A long time ago. A long time ago.
I mean, it's written by a philosophy professor.
No, I saw it in a bookstore and read the first couple of pages and thought, ha! And didn't actually buy it.
Oh, that professor who, like...
By Harry Frankfurt, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, go ahead.
Well, I think it really is about how we relate to... I mean, specifically, there's a specific part about how... So if I say, you know, I was thinking last night, so, like, man, that... I feel like I'm sick as a dog or something, like, or I feel sick as a dog or something. If someone said that, you wouldn't say... You are lying. You have never felt what a dog feels. You know, like, that's bullshit. You know, and whatnot. Like and then he was also talking about these what he called bull sessions, where people talk and everybody knows that there's no truth value to any of anybody's statements, but nobody says anything, or we all assume that it's like Santa Claus or something.
Right.
And
right.
I guess yeah. So I'm wondering. You know, with the, I guess does when a reference changes, I'm having a hard time phrasing it. Do we then start lying or about what used to be what that referred to?
Oh, well, good. We have to decide. You know, what does Napoleon refer to? Does it refer to the original guy or the imposter? Is it false that Napoleon lost at Waterloo? What about Turnip? Which guy are we referring to? Or is it a change? Or what goes on in these cases? Anyway, we're out of time, but let me just say in 10 seconds or less what Evans wants to do. He wants to come back here and say, look, in a sense, both of these guys are right. The central relation is a causal relation. On the other hand, it's not that you're independent of the information. The real question is, what is the causal source of the information? Or at least the causal source of the dominant amount of the information that we all share about this, that's what really determines the reference. And so, yes, look to the body of information, but then don't say, what is it true of? Say, where did it come from, and what is it causally actually about?